possible return to normalcy, the government announced that they had put in place new guidelines and protocols for restaurants to reopen. And many thought, well, maybe this is a good thing, but wait until you take a look at the specific guidelines. I want to take you through each of them one by one. So you did hear Cabinet Secretary Mutahi Kagwe saying all staff must be tested and found to be COVID-free before they would be allowed to work within the restaurant. And remember, restaurants were never really closed, but this is just, they were only required to start doing takeaway service. So if they want to reopen and have patrons, number one, they must test their staff and make sure they're COVID-free. New opening and operating hours between 5 a.m. and 4 p.m. And I know you're thinking the curfew does end at 5 a.m., so that means they won't really open at 5 a.m., would be a little later than that, maybe between 6 o'clock and 6:30, depending on how quickly they can get there and get started. Here's another one. The restaurant must limit the number of customers to 4 people for every 10 square meters, and the tables themselves must also be spaced within the dining area. Now, the tables must be spaced 1.5 meters apart in the dining area, or they must seat customer groups at 1.5 meters apart. And here's another small detail here, that they must maintain the distance from the back of one chair to the other chair at not less than a meter. And if there are any guests who are sitting facing each other, they must sit facing each other at least a distance of 1 meter apart. And here's something that has got everybody talking. Alcohol will be served, but with meals only, and will only be served to those customers who are waiting to be served or during their meal or up to 30 minutes after the meal has ended. I know you've seen the joke of people saying they're going to go and order one samosa and 4 beers. That's just how people are interpreting these ones. And self-service has been temporarily discontinued. So things like salad bars and buffets will not happen. All customers who are having their meals at any restaurant that can comply with this will now be served individually at their dining table by a waiter or waitress. Here's the other thing about hand washing points. Well, they must install adequate portable washing points and accessible wash basins for hand washing purposes, including alcohol-based sanitizers at both the entry and the exit point. Here's another thing, as is happening in many establishments now, including in public transport, all guests must be screened using a contact-free thermometer, or the thermoguns as we know them. And this screening, by the way, is not just for guests, but it is for members of staff as well. And anyone being screened whose temperature is above 37.5, even if it is by a decimal point, should be denied entry to the premises. And this should be immediately reported to the Ministry of Health via their number 719 for further guidance. And here's another thing, the social distancing that we have all become accustomed to, this will also happen within the restaurant, and it must happen. Now, this is for members of staff, so you can imagine in the kitchens, at the counters, they must be 1 meter apart or 3 feet apart, and this is particularly in food preparation areas. Now, once they have done all of this, there will be an inspection that will be done on the specific premises to ensure that they have met each of the criteria, and then they will be given certification or a permit that now says they have met these requirements and can reopen to serve sitting customers. What does this mean for hoteliers and those who own restaurants in the country? Mike Masharia joins me now. He is the CEO of the Hotel Keepers and Caterers Association. Mike, good evening. Thank you for speaking with us on Citizen Television this evening. Let's first start by discussing the cost of implementing each of these protocols that have been provided.
Good evening, Yvonne.
Great. Take us through what it would cost for your members, hoteliers, and restaurant owners to meet these requirements.
First of all, the thing that we should discuss is whether these protocols actually are meant for hotels or just restaurants and and eateries. So the difficulty we are having is that it appears to be only for eateries and not for hotels. When it comes to the cost, there are many costs that are attached to it. First of all, you have the test itself, which is now at 10,000 shillings per person. So if you have 100 staff, you're talking about a million plus. You have the cost of the thermoguns, which are also fairly expensive, at 10,000 apiece. You have costs attaching to putting up wash basins. I'll give you an example. If you operate in a mall, for example, you would have to redo the plumbing, involve an architect, and then get approval again to change the facade of that whole area. So those are, again, more hidden costs. So we are looking at, for a small restaurant, probably around a capital injection of 500,000, a medium-sized one, maybe 1.5 to 2 million, and a large restaurant from about 3 to 5 million, even before you reopen. So it's quite expensive.
Does that cost make this worth it for your members?
Yvonne, it's not just the cost. It's the entire set of protocols. They seem to be very, very stringent on restaurants and eateries, while in other places we are seeing people operating with fairly easier protocols. And in supermarkets, and supermarkets are also selling food and drinks. And we are finding them operating with far much easier protocols. We have not seen a mass testing of supermarket staff. We have not seen the kind of distancing that is being imposed on restaurants. Now, the other thing is that when you operate a restaurant, you operate on masses. You base your business plan on the number of either food that you can sell or the drinks that you can sell. And that is driven by the space that you have. So at the moment, the way the hotels and restaurants are designed, you would have to lose about 60 to 70% of your seating space. And then you'll start asking yourself, then if I'm only going to operate on 30% capacity, is this really worth it?
And
so
Mike,
there's a lot of issues that are attaching to it.
Right. Yeah. And Mike, to add on to that, there's now a new permit, a new certification to ensure that you have met all of this, these guidelines that have been provided. Are you aware of, you know, how much this would cost? Because this seems to be an extra cost in addition to all the other certification that eateries are required to have and probably have already complied with so far.
We have seen a requirement for a new permit. When I went through the protocols, I did not see how much it would cost. But right now, if you operate a restaurant, you have to pay about 13 permits. And that inclusive in that permit is a public health certificate, which is issued by the Ministry of Health. So if we were going to advise, we would advise that any other permit should just be part of the public health certificate. Because again, it's not just about a matter of cost of the permit. It's about how you get it, where you have to go, how many offices you have to visit, and the time that it takes. So there's a lot of things that are coming into it. And when we think critically, we are almost advising our members to just wait. And not open now, and hope that the COVID virus phases out, then it will be an easier opening.
Okay.
But right now, it's very, very difficult under these circumstances.
All right. So you're advising some of your members to wait. So, you know, what happens going forward? Would you have liked to be involved in you know, putting together these protocols to see what would work, what would not, or whether you're comfortable with it at all? And is there going to be any reaching out to the government to get some of these issues cleared up?
Oh, it's always good to to work with government in partnership, and we've done that for many, many years with our CS tourism. We've of late been addressing labor issues with the CS Chelugui, and we've been addressing issues to do with health through the Kenya Health Care Federation, and also directly to the ministry, you know, even when we were working together to bring in people who are going into quarantine in hotels. So there's a very strong partnership, and we must say from the outset that we do believe that the government is doing the right thing, and in terms of control of this virus, and we have a lot of confidence in them. But it would have been nice to get together and find out what would happen, because if you take a restaurant, for example, we have a different classification under the Tourism Act on what a restaurant is against what a hotel is. When you go to the Alcoholic Drinks Control Act, there's a different definition. When you go to the hotel classification, I saw in some of the protocols there about HACCP standards, and those are contained in the classification criteria of hotels, restaurants, and all tourism facilities. And the definition there, the standards are very, very high. So it's something that we could have looked at the existing law, the existing standards, and we could have been able to come together and agreed. The issue of testing is still not clear, because it says you have to go to a government facility. Right now, we are not sure whether it will be available. We would probably have thought it better to bring the staff together in one establishment, conduct the testing there, away from everybody else, and then come for the results later. So there's a lot of areas where, you know, with cooperation. And then we look at the numbers together with the people from the health ministry, check the numbers. Do they make sense? Do they work? And we know that they're coming from a good place.
Yeah.
But if, you know, as a business, you're looking at a business and you're spending more than you're earning, then it becomes difficult.
Absolutely.
At the moment, people are still paying rent to their landlords. Not many people own these premises. So there's a lot of losses that are still being undertaken. So if you bring in another capital injection, huge capital outlay, it becomes very difficult for the people to operate.
Thank you very much. Indeed, Mike Masharia from the Hotel Keepers and Caterers Association, speaking to us on those protocols and guidelines that have been provided by the government on the reopening of restaurants. He says they are happy to comply with the government. Would have been nice to have sat down and be consulted, and that some of the members are considering waiting this out rather than having a capital injection of anything upwards from 500,000 shillings to get new certification to provide services to seating customers. We want to take a break right now on the program.